Hi, welcome to Future Talks. My name is Barbara Zollmann, and I'm the President and CEO of the Korean-German Chamber of Commerce in Seoul, KGCCI. Our chamber is celebrating its 40th anniversary this year, and we started a series of Future Talks to discuss Korean-German business relations and, of course, business opportunities here. Today, we have invited our chamber leadership to the opening session for Future Talks. So welcome all together. And let me quickly introduce our guests. We have Peter Tiedemann, head of Carl Zeiss in Korea, Dr. Yojun Kim, the chairman of BMW Group Korea, and Yan Uhl, CFO of SAP Korea. So we are discussing a few questions which seem relevant to us seeing our 40th anniversary. So Peter, let's start with you. Where do you see Korean-German relations standing in the 40th year of KGCCI's anniversary?
Yeah, thank you, Barbara, first of all, for inviting us. Also, thank you for the question. And, 40 years ago, the Korean-German Chamber of Commerce was founded. It's hard to imagine what the world was like in 1981. And if I remember correctly, then I think the American prisoners were just released by the by Iran. I think it were 52 prisoners held 440 days for hostage. So I can say that the American-Iranian relationships have not changed very much since then, but Korea certainly has. And based on a rigid educational system and a gradual opening of the market economy, Korea has continued to develop tremendously with a growth rate of 9 to 12% in the decade to come after 1981. And that's quite amazing and really unbelievable. The speed before that was even higher. So that was a good time, actually, for with this intensification of business relationships to set up the chamber here, and the foundation of the chamber at that time was really a milestone. If we look how the business was actually happening during that time, then product developments and product exports and also export of know-how was happening from Germany to Korea. Mm-hmm. And that was how it was doing. Companies were transplanting into Korea. More and more German companies were coming here, reinforcing basically the chamber. And however, change was always there and will always be there. And this change has accelerated drastically in the last, I would say, 10 years. And this is not because of the coronavirus, which is definitely an accelerator and a change agent.
Yeah.
What we see now, and recently I got an interesting chart into my hand from OECD, which basically shows a global shift of middle-class earners. So the global middle income class will shift. The landscape will look totally different in 2030. So while in 2010, about, I think, 249 million middle-income class earners were based in Asia, East Asia in particular, of course, China. Mm-hmm. This number will grow to 2.98 billion up to end of this decade, 2030.
So huge potential.
That is a huge shift. The markets will shift. And while all the other countries actually will not grow very much. They will also grow, but not to that, that extent. And what this means, what this all means, is difficult, hard to imagine. But one thing is for certain, that the markets are here, the economic action will be here. And this means for German companies, it means basically either be present, be relevant in these markets, or be globally irrelevant.
That's quite a statement, yeah.
So this is what we have to look at. It will mean that products will not necessarily be developed in Germany and then exported here, but rather will be developed in Asia. And then the product flow will also reverse from Asia into the world. And it will have more other impacts also, including where head offices will be located and some other things. So now I think we have, if this is the paradigm shift to come, then we have to face it and we have to take actions now, because 2030 is not too far away anymore. And we have to prepare for this. And I think here the chamber plays a very important, crucial role, as the chamber is connecting Korea, Germany, people, and of course companies. So this is what we have to look at, and I see here a crucial role for the chamber in future, in facilitating this, in building bridges, and getting people together, and basically focus on these development trends and what they did, and that's what they did in the past, and what this chamber is standing for will be more and more important.
Yeah, you've already opened the view very far, so it also shows from, you know, where Korea is coming from, what it really made a journey. So you looked into 2030, and that's indeed very close. But when we look back just a little bit, HJ, you've been around or at BMW since 1995, so you saw a huge part of this development to where we are here right now. So can you share a little bit what the scenery for Korean-German relations were at that time?
Thanks for your question, Barbara. So many changes, of course. But before we talk about the changes, we better understand the very special or very strong the or historical relationship between Germany and Korea. Actually, Korea was totally destroyed during the Korean War, as you may know that the 1950. Germany was the only one country who supported Korea to develop and overcome those challenges and difficulties from the scratch at the time. And you probably heard about that the approximately 20,000 Korean nurses or Korean coal miners who dispatched to Germany. And actually, their salary or their income was the seed money to develop this country as it is and now. Did you remember that another Asian financial crisis in 1997? You probably remember that, right? That was also a very difficult time for all of us in Korea here. I clearly remember that at the time, the American or Japanese the enterprise did withdraw the whole their investment. They took back the, all the money from Korean market. And all other countries actually followed that trend later on. Again, Germany was the only one country who has a strong confidence and trust on the Korean economic power and the future success. And they do not, they didn't hesitate or nervous at all. Instead of that, they continuously invest a lot of money to Korean market. That was really hard to overcome the financial crisis there.
So very special relationship.
That's correct. So that means, so Germany always remains as a good friend or reliable partner for Korea. This really is something special to Korean people. Korean people are always thinking and always saying like this way, we owe something to Germany. That's the reason why the general perception in Germany or German product, German companies are really positive and favorable to us. Mm-hmm. And this is a good springboard to make a big success of a lot of German business group doing business here, mm-hmm. Korea, so far under this atmosphere. Of course, if I look back, BMW started very small and humble stage in 1995 when we set up our subsidiary. The huge import duty on foreign car was just one of the obstacle at the time, simple obstacle, I would say. At the time, the ownership of foreign car was the subject of national tax audit. Can you imagine these things? That means to buy foreign car was totally prohibited. Mm-hmm. Because still that time...
So prohibited by law?
Not the law, but practically.
Okay, practically in the
social sentiment.
Yes.
Was totally against the foreign product or foreign company. Because there was the reason, clearly. Mm-hmm. During that time, the Korean government and the Korean society, we have to develop our economy and protect our industry and local companies like that way. So protectionism was so strong mm-hmm. at the time. In the first year, in 1995, soon after we set up the company, I remember that we sold 707 units. At the time, the foreign car market share in Korea here was 0.02%. It's merely nothing, yeah. What would you say? But nowadays, this year, 2021, we are selling 70,000 units. Mm-hmm. It's 100 times. Mm-hmm. This is a big change and big success. With this volume, BMW Korea became number five within the group after China, America, Germany, and England.
Nowadays.
Yeah. Nowadays, mm-hmm. number five market. Not only BMW, actually, Mercedes-Benz, Audi, and Volkswagen. Mm-hmm. They are also very much enjoying mm-hmm. the business here in Korea at the same level of BMW, almost. Yeah.
So in that segment, Korea is a very important market
changed.
For German
Absolutely.
Companies.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's correct. And the other statistical factor clearly shows that the import car market segment is approximately 30% in the Korean market. Within that segment, import car, German product car, maintain almost 70%. It's a big portion mm-hmm. as occupied by a German product mm-hmm. at the
so
time.
So this also means a lot of employment that German companies are providing in Korea.
That's right. Through our KGCCI, we have a statistic. We hired more than the 100,000 local mm-hmm. employees a year. Mm-hmm. That's a good signal. What is the success factor on these things, German product, or as a German company? It's a strong country brand and a very powerful the company brand, mm-hmm. and also German engineering performance, and distinguished design. Mm-hmm. The fact is, this is a new criteria from the Korean consumer to buy a car. Mm-hmm. So we German companies, actually German product, really changed a lot the general sentiment or criteria of consumer groups there.
So we know Korean customers are very demanding customers.
That they very much like the German product at this moment. Not only this sales part, we BMW also developed the local automobile parts supplier mm-hmm. during the last 10, 15 years. More than 450 local companies provide their mm-hmm. local product. It's a mm-hmm. parts supply to BMW mm-hmm. group.
So you don't only sell into the market, but you also buy huge
yes,
supplies
including
from
Korea. The lithium battery for electric car mm-hmm. or some premium tires, for example. It's a lot of area, 450 companies. And in the range of 35 billion euro mm-hmm. volume. This is big.
Oh, yeah.
So I would say business environment surrounding us is getting better and better. It's more positively. And because Korea clearly want to be a global player. Mm-hmm. That means time to time, they really try to get rid of unnecessary guidance or policy, which were against the foreign business group here, continue to rectify, modify the policy to in line with the globalized, mm-hmm. global standard. Mm-hmm. So, which is good, this one. More open and more accept different culture. So lots of changes. in more positive and favorable way in the last 40 years, I would say.
Mm-hmm. So that's quite a journey from customer sentiment not to buy foreign products to becoming such an important market, both for import, export. So yes, that's quite a story. Well, let's ask Yan. You are in a totally different sector, and that's why it's interesting here. IT infrastructure and use are one of Korea's outstanding features and success factors. What importance do you give this factor for Korea's further development and cooperation potential between Germany and Korea?
So, first of all, thank you also from my side for having me here on this panel and sharing a couple of points of view on the topic of Korea and Germany's joint future, as well as the digital collaboration that we can be actually working on. So first of all, I believe that Korea and Germany can form a great partnership. German businesses are great when it comes to planning. Korean businesses are excellent when it comes to execution. There's a lot to learn from each other, mm-hmm. and even more to be done together. Both countries heavily rely on manufacturing, and digitizing manufacturing, for example, via Industry 4.0, is a great area where both Korean and German businesses can collaborate. At the same time, the challenge ahead is a much bigger one. It's about digitalizing business models and commercializing those new business models, as opposed to just digitizing manufacturing. Mm-hmm. It's a big change, big difference. Mm-hmm. And this is the real challenge ahead. Korea and Germany are both very innovative countries. Korea was once again named the world's most innovative countries in 2021 by the Bloomberg Innovation Index. Germany is now in the fourth position after having led the index in 2020. The challenge at stake is how to transform the great results of innovative R&D into sustainable business models that are commercially viable. Interestingly, Korea scores extremely high across all categories when it comes to innovation. However, when it comes to productivity, Korea scores less well. Korea is leading when it comes to bringing technology to everyday's life in the area of business to consumer, B2C. Mm-hmm. Germany is excelling when it comes to digitalizing B2B. And the 2021 study from the World Economic Forum, in collaboration with McKinsey, shows how Germany and German companies across the globe host lighthouse manufacturing companies that actually drive that innovation and bring it into market. Mm-hmm. So Korean and German companies can cooperate, co-innovate, and shall be going to market in the B2B environment. On the German side, this is also supported by the policy guidelines of the Indo-Pacific region, by the federal government, where South Korea is explicitly mentioned as a key partner. To do so, businesses and their respective governments on both sides, including the European Union, need to support a real open exchange, which is also supported by the regulatory environment. For example, a cooperation with regards to Gaia-X, a federated data infrastructure that could be beneficial for both Korea and the European Union, as well as Germany, to enable actually those business models from digitizing manufacturing to digitalizing business models into actually going into this promising future that Germany and Korea can be on together. Mm-hmm. So talking about this future, since you, Barbara, are leading the Korean-German Chamber of Commerce in Korea, what do you make out of this very rich past, this very promising present? Where do you think we'll be headed when it comes to the future and how to do things together and being enabled by the Chamber?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I think you already gave the answers all together. So I think the picture is that Korea and Germany and their companies are very compatible in their industries. They have different strengths, but at the same time, they can bring German technologies together with Korea's power in implementation. So there are a lot of good things happening there. At the same time, HJ, you have described how Korea developed from a poor country after the Korean War to now number 10 on the global world scale. So Korea has changed and so has Germany's role. So I think in the future, Korea and Germany are definitely at par. They are two powerhouses. Germany, I think, has to make sure that it really stays on the heels of Korea, because Korea is developing extremely fast. much faster than Europe when you compare what has changed in Korea in 10 years and you compare this what has changed in Europe for 10 years, you see there is a difference in speed. So I think German companies have fantastic potential here with the existing industries that now have to be taken into the future by, you know, all digitalization, AI, big data, and so on. And there are new growth engines coming right now with hydrogen, new mobility overall, and many other things. So if I can give the advice to German companies, then it's definitely to look at Asia, look to a broader range of countries within Asia, Korea included, and then make sure that you're really as fast and as matching the demanding and innovative requests here in the country. So my outlook for the future is pretty bright for the Korean-German relations and business opportunities going forward, definitely. Yeah, I think we are almost coming to the end already, although I have so many questions for you. But to round this up, how would you, in one word or two times one word, characterize Korea? And how do you see the future of Korean-German relations? Just one word for each. Characterize Korea and how do you see the future of Korean-German relations? Yan, I start with you.
I would say very pragmatic and highly promising when it comes to the future.
Peter.
Yeah, I would say dynamic and collaborative.
Okay. I'd say powerhouse and at equals. And HJ, what do you say?
Well, I would like to say the fast mover with the speed of a can-do attitude. Uh-huh. This is really the power of Korea, and the continue. We will definitely keep these things for the time being to be a global player, as you described through your colleagues. But for the relationship, for the future relationship with Germany, I'm really extremely positive and optimistic because I clearly feel that there is a certain movement to study and learn German system, not only business sectors, but also structure of the politics, for example, and some social, and those value and philosophy from Germany. This is one of the movement in Korea at this moment. We want to copy those contents direction and procedure of Industry 4.0, for example. And also, now we talk about the stakeholders instead of shareholders. This is a big change. During last, really, a lot of decades, we only talk about doing better is good. But in these days, people talk about doing good is better. And quite influenced by some German social economy, I would say. This world of social economy is one of a big issue at Korea at this moment. So Korea-Germany or Germany-Korea has a very bright future to go together later on. And I strongly believe that KGCCI will take a really important role to expand this relationship or enhanced more positive or favorable business environment between two countries.
That was almost the perfect last word. So thank you very much for participating in this opening session for Future Talks. And we will be back with future episodes talking about Korean-German business relations and exciting new industry potentials very soon. See you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
감사합니다.
Bye. 감사합니다.